Bless the people in this congregation, who by word and example aid your servant intern, Pastor Brooke Apple, in learning to do the ministry for which she is being prepared. And as we diligently work together, grant that our lives may be enriched and our ministries fulfilled with joy in the glory of your holy name. Amen.
The Apostle Paul writes, "Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of service, but the same Lord, and there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone." 1 Corinthians 12:4-6. In the coming year, Pastor Brooke will work with the supervising pastor and this congregation to be formed as a pastor and to develop skills for pastoral ministry. I ask you, Pastor Brooke, are you willing to assume your partnership in ministry here? And will you seek to engage in that ministry to God's glory? If so, answer, "I am ready and I ask God to help and guide me."
I'm ready and I ask God to help and guide me.
In the coming year, the members of this congregation and the supervising pastor are asked to accept this intern as a partner in ministry, welcoming her into their homes, sharing in her learning and growth, and encouraging, supporting, and praying for her. Now I ask you, will you proceed as a partner in ministry and uphold and support her in every way? If so, answer, "Yes, by God's help."
Yes, by God's help.
Almighty God, by whose call we are at work, bless us in our labors together. And then let us pray. God, we ask you to bless this congregation and to sustain all the labor in it. Make us faithful to your word. Empower us to show one another in all creation your justice and love, and bring all that lasts to your heavenly home. Through Jesus Christ, and then let's all participate in the blessing that we might say together, a blessing for Pastor Brooke. We join together in the words. May God go before you to show you the way, be behind you to encourage and inspire you, be beside you as your faithful friend, be above you to watch over you, be within you to give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a few gifts that we want to present to you.
Every year, we get a few gifts for the intern. And just take the stuffing out of here. We won't take out every little thing, but as everyone knows, we love our black. Give every intern a little blackjack apparel. So we got her a sweatshirt, and if it's the wrong size, you can exchange it. And then we also got her an athletic pass, so you can attend the games and cheer on our blackjacks. And there are some other things in there for you. So
thank you.
So let's welcome Pastor.
Hallelujah. We sing it, but Chris has got it.
or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither, and all that they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like the chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Thanks for the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The lessons from James, chapter 3, 13, through chapter 4, verses 3, 7, and 8. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness or in wisdom. You ask and do not receive, because you ask wrongly, in order to spend what you give on your pleasures. Submit yourself, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. The word of the Lord.
If you'll stand with me for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel this morning is a reading from St. Mark, the 9th chapter. Glory to you, Lord. The disciples went on there and passed through Galilee. Jesus did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples and saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying, and were too afraid to ask him. And when they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" They were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. And so Jesus sat down and called the 12 and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." And then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, Lord Christ. You may be seated. Well, Jesus is with his disciples and is referring about the prediction of his death and also of his resurrection. And the disciples did not understand this, and so they were silent, they didn't say anything to Jesus. But then Mark tells us as they were walking to Capernaum, along the way they were discussing some things. They were actually arguing about some things. And I don't know if you caught on what they were arguing about. They were arguing about who is the greatest. Who is the greatest? So I just thought maybe we could just do a little guessing game this morning. Who do you think is the greatest Olympic athlete of all times? Who is the greatest? Any guesses? No one wants to take a guess at this? How about Carrie Tolleson? There we go. Good guess. How about Michael Phelps? Michael Phelps has had 18 gold medals, 22 medals in all. I don't think anybody has surpassed that. Michael Phelps, he was one of the greatest swimmers ever. How about who would you say is the greatest American boxer of all time? This should be an easy one. Yep, that's right. What did he used to say? "I float like a butterfly and sting like a..." to be, and of course he claimed himself as being the greatest, right? Muhammad Ali. Who do you Americans say would be the greatest scientist of all? Who do you think would be the greatest scientist? Albert Einstein. How about the greatest basketball player? How about that one? Might depend on the position, right? Might depend on whose team they're on. That might change our. But how about Larry Bird? How about Will Chamberlain? How about Michael Jordan? How about more recently, some say that LeBron James might be the greatest basketball player of all time. What about the greatest singing group? What do you think the greatest singing group is? The Beatles. Well, they've had the most platinum albums. So, the Beatles, the greatest singing group. How about the greatest American president? Who would you say the greatest American president is? Well, actually, Americans have taken a poll on this, and it is Abraham Lincoln, the greatest American president. So the list of the greatest pastor of all time. How about that? The list of greats can go on and on and on, right? I mean, there are a lot of great people. I mean, it's one thing to be a great Olympian. It's one thing to be a great boxer. It's one thing to be a great golfer. It's one thing to be a great scientist, to be the greatest president of all time. It's quite another thing to have a need to be great. Those are two different things, aren't they? To have a need to be great. To have a need to be number one. To have a need to be better than others. None of us really like those people who need to be the greatest. Those people are kind of hard to hang around, aren't they? They need to be number one. They need to be on top all of the time. They need to be the greatest. And so the question of who is the greatest is a question that we ask ourselves, I think, a lot. And it's certainly a question that the disciples of Jesus were asking themselves. This question was on their minds in this morning's gospel. And I think it's on our minds as well. I mean, what is it that drives us? Is it wrong to want to be the greatest? Is it wrong to want to be successful in what you do? Is it wrong to live our lives in a way that allows us to be successful and great? No, those things aren't wrong. But to want to put others under your greatness, there might be something wrong about that. There might be something that Jesus says about that. What drives us, not so much to be individual successes in life, but to glory in that success. I think that's the issue that we're getting here. It's wanting to glory in that success that might come our way in life. For that kind of attitude leads to jealousy, or at least it leads to provoking jealousy. It is because we think that winners are loved more than winners. I'm not sure. Maybe we are insecure about whether we are any good or whether people really like us. And maybe we still fight for admiration because it assures us of something that we might doubt ourselves. So there is this conversation, I think, that we need to hear. If you wonder about greatness, as I wonder about greatness, there is this conversation that Jesus has with his disciples. And they are on the road to Jerusalem. And with Jesus, of course, that's an important thing. To be on the road to Jerusalem means something very specific. And Jesus comes right out and says it first thing. He tells his disciples, the Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands. The Son of Man is to be killed. And now this is not the first time that Jesus' disciples have been confronted with this news. But they have a hard time accepting this news, that Jesus would actually be condemned to death on a cross, the most humiliating death of all. Because they thought Jesus was the greatest. They thought Jesus was the greatest, and so this type of dying did not seem fair or right to them. But they're probably pondering his death. And Mark tells us they're on the way now not to Jerusalem, but they're on the way to Capernaum. And they're talking amongst themselves. And maybe they're talking amongst themselves because they realize that Jesus is going to die. And who will take over? So they talk about who is the greatest. They were arguing about who is the greatest. And so Jesus, after they had arrived, he sat down with them. And I think that's significant. Whenever Jesus sits down, he's pausing. Jesus sits down and he's about to tell them something very important. So that was the traditional posture of a great teacher, of a great rabbi, is to sit down before they taught. And so Mark tells us Jesus sat down and he looked at each of his disciples in their eyes and he said, whoever wants to be first must be last of all and must be servant of all. And then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it, the child, in his arms, he said to them, whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me, meaning God. Welcome God. Welcome God into your midst. Welcome God into your life. He takes a child and he embraces that child as a demonstration of who is the greatest among us. And we've been looking this last several weeks, we've been looking and asking the question about who is our neighbor, right? We've been, that great commandment that Jesus gives his disciples, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all your strength, and that you shall love your neighbor as yourself, right? So thinking about that great commandment, and thinking about what Jesus does today, who do you think is the neighbor in the story today? Who is the neighbor? Who is the neighbor? It's the child, right? Jesus makes that very clear. He takes the child. The child is the neighbor. That is the one for whom we are to love. And we love children. Well, we love children for many reasons. We embrace children for many reasons. We love them, we embrace them, we consider them our neighbor, we teach them because they demonstrate an innocence, they demonstrate a sweetness for us. They demonstrate a beauty for us. But Jesus was not talking about the innocence of children. Jesus was not talking about the beauty of children. Jesus was not talking about how children seem to always be able to tell the truth. This is not why Jesus took a child in his arms and blessed that child and embraced that child. You see, in Jesus' day, they understood children differently than how we understand children. In Jesus' day, children were considered as a nobody. Children were nobody. They were expendable. In fact, in Jesus' day, oftentimes children were left exposed out on the streets of the city to be placed in a trash heap to die because they were nobody. They were expendable. So Jesus, you see, when Jesus was saying, and when Jesus took a child in his arms and welcomed that child, Jesus is saying to us, we don't welcome children because they're innocent and sweet and beautiful. We welcome children because they're, or others, because they're nobody. That's what Jesus is inviting us to welcome. To look after in this world is the nobody, the expendable in life. Children were expendable in Jesus' day. Children were nobody. Nobody's in Jesus' day. In our long history, I think we human beings have managed to find ways to marginalize one another. to make one another a nobody, to make one another an outcast, to point the finger and say, well, they're not like us. They're not even human. They are nobody. And Jesus is saying no. Jesus is saying no to this. The one thing that you can't welcome or don't have to welcome, this is the one that Jesus says you must welcome among you. You must welcome the nobodies. And not only must you welcome them, he says, even with his body language, you must embrace them. You must take them in and embrace them. Not only must you welcome them, but you must be willing to be their servant. You must be willing to let them be first and you last. So Jesus is saying to his disciples, and I think Jesus is saying to us, I want you to be great servants. And this is how you love God. And this is how you love your neighbor, is to be great servants. Now sometimes that can look kind of strange to us. And I think last week we got that comment. When we were out trying to be the hands and the feet of God in this community, when we were doing our service projects, I mean, I heard this not from one person, but I heard this from others. Why are you helping them? Why are you spending time helping that person? You see, because when you're a servant, it might seem kind of strange to do what you do. It might seem strange to serve to others. And the best analogy I have on this is when I was in school. I ran long distance in school, so I got stuck with running a mile, 2 miles, that sort of thing. And I still remember one race I was in Iowa, Minnesota. We were running the 2 mile, and there were two twins that were right next to me as we began the race. And the one twin turned to me and said, now, how many times is this around the football field? That's what we ran around the football field. How many times? I said to him, well, for the 2 mile, that's 8 times around. You gotta run a quarter mile. So it's this is a 2 mile race. So looked at me and was like, this is the 2 mile race? Are you kidding me? I gotta run 2 miles. Yeah, this is the 2 mile race. And so we the gun went off and we started running, and the one twin was in front of me, and we got one lap around of the 16 laps, and he collapsed. I mean, down he went, and he just laid there on the grass. Because I ran so long ago, we actually ran on grass. All right, he collapsed. He and the rest of us were like, what in the world is he lying down for, you know? And his other twin caught up to him. And when his other twin arrived to the place, he went down with him. So both the twins were lying there on the grass, and the other twin kind of put his hand around, his arm around his shoulder, and they laid there for a little while, and then all of a sudden they got up, and then they started running again. And so they started running around, and they got maybe 2 laps this time, and down the one twin went again. Just collapsed, and the other twin caught up to him, and the other twin went down as well. We thought, that is so strange. What in the world is going on? We never thought that we should stop and help them. But to them, it didn't look strange at all. To the twins, it didn't look strange at all to serve one another in that way. But why did it not look strange? Because they were family, right? It didn't look strange to them at all. If you want to be great, Jesus says, then you must be a servant of all. You must be willing to be last, to be a servant of all. And you must consider yourself to be family, to help one another, where no one is greater, no one is lesser, but you see your family, to be servant of all. And I don't know who demonstrates this greater than Jesus Christ, because who is the greatest servant of all? Jesus was the greatest servant of all, right? The cross teaches us that. That Jesus took on the cross so that we all might be great and so that we all might be servants of one another. So that's our calling. And that's not only our calling, that is our living. That is our livelihood, to be servants of one another, to be servants of all. Praise be to God. Hallelujah.